Thank you. I'm very sorry I was late. I had another meeting I had to chair this morning. I'm Rafael Jiménez. I'm the ELIXIR technical coordinator. As you might know, ELIXIR is one of the European new infrastructures. I'm not going to say much about that because I think we have to focus on BioJS. So, I'm very pleased that Manuel appointed me as a chair, the only chair of this conference, to chair this session. And I'm really pleased to introduce the few speakers that we're going to have in this session. It's an honor to introduce Henning. As you might know, Henning is a good friend, he's a colleague, and for many years he's been my line manager. I think I'm very grateful to Henning for many reasons, but one of the reasons is that actually he was one of the first believers of BioJS, and as well supporters, and you might know that the first component actually happened within Henning's team, as well as the first specification and the push of the first BioJS registry. So I'm very grateful myself, and I know many people from the BioJS community. And well, he's been involved in a lot of work related to visualization, and I'm looking forward to know a little bit more about your ideas and the vignettes. Thank you for Henning.
Okay, so thank you for the nice introduction, and thanks for the organization of this meeting. So I think so far it has been a very enjoyable meeting. I'm going to give a few vignettes from my perspective on around Reactome, but also really things which I think are relevant to consider for BioJS, where we are now, for when we want, how we want to go forward. But first, quite a number of introductory slides. So, if you're here, you know the basic concepts of BioJS. For me, the two main ones are from a developer-centric point, minimizer, or overall, we want to develop reusable JavaScript components to present biological information. And at least for us, this started fairly modest, with really having relatively small components which do one relatively small task, but do it well. We discussed a lot this morning about the challenges of complex visualization, visual analytics, but at least the start of BioJS, and I think this is still to a significant part the present, was really about much more small modules you ideally pull off the shelf, drop them into your web page, and they do something useful. So the developer's perspective on why BioJS can be, I think, summarized under minimize redundant development. But there's another perspective, which for me is as important, and that is the user perspective, the maximization of the recognition effect. So we want to have reused the same components to do the same task, because then the user is already used to seeing this kind of information visualized in this way across multiple websites. So if we have, let's say, a visualization component in a pathway database, and you can zoom in, as I will show later on, to a protein structure, then hopefully, because we are using BioJS, this user might already have interacted with the same component on, let's say, the PDB side. And so there's less of a learning curve for interacting with the individual components, and therefore an immediate feeling of, I'm familiar with this, I've already seen this. And this is important for small, simple components, but of course much more for components which have a more complex, advanced functionality. So these are really, for me, the two major points. The motivation for BioJS, for me, came from the fact that we have quite a number of resources, obviously at the EBI, but also just in my group, which range from mass spectrometry-based protein expression data in the PRIDE database, via molecular interaction data in the INTECT database. Then if you link molecular interactions into pathways, if you add directionality and the human construct, which pathways are, you get to the data which we store in the Reactome database of curated human pathways. And if you then add mathematical, rigid description of a pathway, then you get to ultimately to a predictive simulatable systems biology model, the kind of data which is stored in the biomodels database. And so across all of these, we have these reoccurring visualization tasks, show a protein sequence, show a protein structure if the user wants to have more detailed information. And so this is where the motivation for BioJS came from. Now zooming in to the Reactome database, the aim of Reactome is to make descriptions like this of a pathway computationally accessible, computable, and collect these in a database. What you can do, what we do is the basic element of Reactome is a reaction. Reactions are then linked into pathways, and ultimately you get to pathway maps like this one. You can then do pathway analysis. You send your expression data set, whatever, protein expression, gene expression, chemical expression, to Reactome. You get an analysis of the overrepresented pathways, and then you can see the results of your analysis, how your data set maps to all of Reactome on a genome scale on this sort of high-level overview of the pathways. You can zoom in to into the hierarchical Reactome pathway structure and ultimately to the detailed pathway maps, and you can then see down to the detail of how your individual data maps onto, let's say, the complexes in Reactome with the relevant expression values. So this is what Reactome does. Where it gets interesting for BioJS is what we call the pathways portal, where we are trying to give additional information in the context of the pathway which happens to be in focus and allow the user to select one entity, a group of entities in this pathway map, and then get additional data, additional information on these entities from other resources in the spirit of BioJS. These are not necessarily directly BioJS components. Many of these have sister components, which are, or brother components, which are in the BioJS registry for technical reasons, mainly that Reactome uses GWT. They are not necessarily directly BioJS components, but it is really the aim of BioJS, which we are using in Reactome. So this component, where you can click on a chemical entity, you click on structure, and then you get the chemical formula from the KEBI database. And this is a widget which is provided by KEBI. So we haven't developed this. This comes from the KEBI database. So this is really the first example of the component reuse. And then you can see the sort of familiarity effect. So this is the same representation in the KEBI data parent database. Same thing for an entire reaction. We don't have a high coverage of these, but for some reactions, you can just click on the reaction in Reactome, and you get the fully chemically balanced reaction representation again through a KEBI widget in this, in the context of the pathway where you're looking at it in Reactome, but it's something which is done and provided by KEBI. Again, you see the similar representation in the parent database. Same thing for structure, for protein structures. If you click on a protein, the tab, the same tab structures shows the link and a short overview of structural properties from the PDBE database. And then this gives direct links to the PDBE, but also this kind of providing informative links to PDBE is used in other databases because, again, it's provided by the PDBE group rather than something which Reactome has invented. We also can import protein interaction data. This is not yet anything which is an independent widget. This might happen in the future. Here we get into more complex widget. This is the widget which comes from the expression atlas, where for the set of entities, it might be a single protein or a whole pathway, which you've selected in the pathway window, you then get expression data from the ArrayExpress expression atlas. And of course, the idea is that you then can compare the data from in reference data sets from the expression atlas to the data you might have painted on the pathway based on your own data. And again, this widget comes from Array Express rather than from the Reactome team. We did quite a lot of work with them to integrate it, but the idea is, again, we reuse the software, but also for this fairly complex widget where you can interact with in different ways. You can click on the different tissues and they are lit up here on this little depiction of the human. You will already probably have seen this in the Array Express database, and so you will be familiar with how to interact with this, what it really, how it works. So you have the visual recognition effect. But this then also leads to the points where I would like, or where I would like to point out challenges to BioJS, because this, I think, is a very successful project. Reactome is a fairly, well, it's a medium use level database, I would say. It would be a very nice reference for BioJS components in actual usage in quite a variety of different data types. But this has been, we set up the Pathways portal, well, we started the development about 2 years ago, and it's been in production for about a year or so. And there's already a couple of problems cropping up. Like, if you now pay attention to the details of this Array Express widget, this is how the counterpart looks like in the expression atlas. And you clearly see it looks very similar, but it's not the same anymore. When we set up the Reactome Pathways portal, it was the same. But of course, evolution goes on. And the more external components you integrate into your own application, the more you have the challenge of diverging evolution of components. And in principle, you can say, OK, we can buffer against this. We freeze the component. And we then keep on using it until we have time to update it to get back into sync with the sort of parent resource. But the problem is that a key part of the BioJS concept and implementation in many cases is these are visualization components which are linked tightly with web services. And in this case, it was just that someday our component didn't work anymore. And that was because the expression atlas brought out this new component, which does more or less the same, but it required a change of the web service interface. So although we had isolated against the change of the source code and we weren't directly loading the component from Array Express, the component still didn't work because the web service had changed. And this is something which has happened, or which easily happens. And of course, the more you integrate components, the bigger this challenge is. The other challenge is more a software engineering challenge, but again, one which is not hypothetical, but which we really encountered. And this is in two aspects. One is isolation of components. If you have a complex website and you start having lots of components which have complex functionality and you integrate them onto this website and you don't do a good modularization and really encapsulation, then you have the effect which we had in the beginning where the Array Express widget would be very nice once it showed up, but it would block the entire web page until it showed up. So you really have to make sure, or we really have to make sure for BioJS that we provide components which really are well isolated and don't block each other, especially when we think about integrating, building complex websites for many components. The other side issue is, again, on the kind of evolution aspect. So I said our service broke at some point when this widget was updated. We got the Array Express, the Expression Atlas team to reinstate what we needed. But unfortunately for them, this is now only one sort of thing which is relatively invisible to them. And so this morning, when I prepared the screenshot, this is actually a screenshot from this morning. So it had failed because it was not anymore in the direct scope of the team which maintains the web service. And so the other lesson to learn is we need to provide ways to make sure that the components are easily testable and that they can be tested automatic, that they are always up to date and don't fail because something in the underlying system has failed, so that as somebody who uses the component, you can easily set up tests which at least warn you something is wrong. The maintenance then is still a challenge, because in this case I had to rather than telling developers in my team, I had to mail the expression atlas team, listen, there's something wrong, I didn't quite know whom to mail, so it's an additional challenge you have, which of course is in general modular software development challenge, but one which is probably put more into evidence in BioJS. And this is basically just the summary of all that I've already said on the examples. All of this is not really rocket science, but it's things which we really have experienced in operating the Reactome side very much in this way of integrating components from different sources. And I think we have learned quite a few lessons which are really important for going forward with BioJS development. And of course, to end on a nice note, and also to do shameless self-advertising, I would like to introduce one nice component which will get my mouse. So this is a new widget which is part of the BI Complex portal, but will again be available as a BioJS widget, which allows to show really the details of a protein complex, where you don't have the structural data, but you have things like which are the contact interfaces, and you can see both proteins or chemicals which are only known to be a part of the complex, but also where the contact interfaces are shown, known on the different participating proteins. You can go all the way down to that level of detail. Thank you. I would like to thank. I almost in historical order, John Gomez, who really did the first BioJS components, Rafael, who supervised that work and came up with the idea, Manuel for really taking the banner and driving the community, really. I think otherwise it would be now a footnote in scientific activity. And Antonio Fabregat has done a lot of the Reactome development I presented. Colin Cole produced the complex viewer I just showed. And of course, all BioJS contributors. Thank you. Thank you.
We have time for a couple of questions.
Thank you. I just wonder whether you had any recommendations for people developing, say, the BioJS IO software modules that will be, say, reading in web services, and obviously having version web services. Whether you have any recommendations from your experience as to how to implement tests and how to integrate maybe the web service providers into those tests.
I have one suggestion which is quite challenging one. I didn't mention that in detail, it's on the slide. So what I think would be valuable for BioJS in this context, but also in general, is a very simple registry for web services where you just register the URL and you are the provider of that URL, and then you can subscribe to this with your own email as a user of that web service, and when somebody intends to change the web service, then he can at least mail all the users. Could be really something like a three column table in a very primitive web application, and I think that would already help to get an advanced warning at least for this. Otherwise, of course, there's lots of testing and so on, but I think this would be one way of isolating a bit against the changing web services.
Usually semantic versioning is used to indicate compatibility and changes.
Yes, then you detect it, but the point is that what I think is important is to have a direct communication, not only to detect the problem when it's there, but to have a way for the provider of a web service to give advance warning to the users.
that's the point. Because if you are, if the service is broken, you might need a week to fix it. And then your service is down for a while. While if you have an advance warning then and you know something will change by 15th of August, then you have time to actually do something.
As a user of the service, you would not update to the next major version without knowing that it will break things. That's the point of semantic versioning, really.
That does assume that the data providers will always make everything available from every single version available, which may not be possible
which
if it's coming from a live database. And
that's a theoretical concept that you always keep the old versions available,
which
rarely
happens.
So does React Home have its own BioJS component? So it consumes several other BioJS components. Does it expose its own?
No, again, because it's I understand on a technical level that GWT doesn't work play well with the current BioJS. React Home is completely open source, but at the moment we are not providing BioJS components. We are thinking of providing especially the pathway viewer, this what you saw there as a sort of central window, as the BioJS component, but that is currently on the internet, not yet in.
So it's kind of, is it kind of seen across the EBI? Certainly people that I talk to at the EBI are very keen on re-engineering certain tools and certain pieces of software to be much more dependent on web services and client-side rendering. And that really supports componentization, asynchronicity, and all these good things that you need to do, that you embody in BioJS. So is that the way that the organization is going as a whole, or is it sort of not really formalized, but it's just the technology is
it's definitely going in that direction. But it's not some, and BioJS is kind of an officially EBI supported technology, but it's at the moment, it's a bit, well, ultimately I think we need serious funding getting into quality assurance for BioJS components and for really strengthening the framework. I think it's a bit of a hen and egg problem, which is really the challenge. But there is clearly a commitment from EDI to support the technology.
Can I add something? And it's the fact that BioJS is an ad hoc random collection of things that people put somewhere. Right? So, and all of the contributions are driven by the community. So there isn't like,
wait, we are going to go to that.
Why? Because funding. And so it's, but I think, you know, having that in mind, certainly there are efforts and there are potential opportunities to develop new things. But you know, it's a massively parallel type of development.
Good, thank you very much. Thank you, Henning. Very interesting presentation. So let me introduce the next speaker, probably doesn't need introduction, Ian Mulvany, head of technology in eLife, and also well known because of his contribution to Mendeley. I was introduced to Ian by Joe McIntyre, and I remember the first meeting that we had was at the EBI with Henning, actually. So, and I think that meeting was about BioJS. And since then, Ian has been a great supporter of BioJS, has been involved in many different ways. So I thank Ian for his contribution, and I really welcome and look forward for his presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So I've got a few caveats before I start. The first one is, I've never tried giving a talk like this before. I haven't given this talk before. I don't know how long it's going to take. So if someone could give me a 5-minute warning, that would be really great, because what I have to say is really very simple, but I'm going to go about it in a very complicated way. The next caveat that I have is, this is really an opinion piece. So I want to talk about how we can get visualizations integrated in the literature, into the scientific literature. But I'm talking about a theoretical approach, one that I think is a good one to look at. But I take off my hat to F1000. They're way ahead of what we're doing at eLife. And really what my talk today is about is why we suck at eLife at doing this and what we might need to do to get over that. And then my last caveat is, this probably should have sat in the industry section, so I'm not going to talk about BioJS, and I apologize for stealing your time in that way. So with those caveats aside, I'm going to see if this works. We'll go to there. Okay, so I'm going to give the initial spiel on what you may need to know about eLife. We're an academic publisher. Very specifically, we are funded by the Wellcome Trust, the Howard Hughes Medical Institute, and the Max Planck Society, which makes us quite unique. We are a not-for-profit. It's really fast to publish in eLife, much faster than everybody else. You might want to know. We only get reviews by active scientists, and we have the best peer review system in the world. Come and ask me about it later. I always get asked about the impact factor. The impact factor is a steaming pile of statistical nonsense, and we refuse to talk about it or to advertise the impact factor.
I'm
not going to talk about it. And we do have a remit to experiment. We have a remit to experiment, and we've done some experimental things, which I'm not going to talk about. But that's one of the reasons why I'm interested in BioJS and interested in pushing the boundaries. And someone was talking about how you might want to be in an industry that is 20 years behind the curve. Welcome to academic publishing. So on that, I was going to talk next about how do we make a scientific paper? How do we make a scientific paper? So the author submits their nice Word file to us. and then the Word file gets converted to a shitty PDF. And then that gets converted to a nice-ish XML. And the XML gets converted to a nice PDF, which you all want, but it makes me have a sad face. And it's reasonable that you want the PDF, because you like to read without the internet. You like to think that you can print things even though you don't. And it's effectively a universal format. So I'm going to show you what that looks like. So this is where the talk goes a little bit nuts, because I'm going to try and actually open up some real files. So you will go through the pain of sending us like an actual Word doc, and we will take it and we will strip out all of its images and all of your formatting. And so we will then start with an artifact that looks a bit like this after you've gone through the pain of uploading your Word document and all of your individual files. And like I said, we then take that Word document and we convert it to something that looks a bit like this, which many of you may recognize if you've ever done reviewing for a publisher. And we then take that file and we eventually send it to India, where it gets typeset and converted into structured data. And then that's where we get the kind of nice-ish XML, which looks a bit like this. So we have structure, and that nice-ish XML will then finally get converted to our nice pretty PDF like this. And so we're doing a lot of things here which are constrained by the historical workflows of the publishing industry. And two of the main constraints in this workflow are that you guys, as a consumer group, want this. So if we stop producing this, you're probably not going to publish with us. That's the first constraint. The next constraint, and one of the reasons why we actually produce XML, is that that XML gets sent to many places. It gets sent to EuroPubMed Central. It gets sent to PubMed Central and to PubMed. And these guys require that XML. So how many of you here use PubMed or PubMed Central? How many of you would be really pissed if we published one of your papers and did not put it in there? So that's why you can't have the nice things. We need to create the XML to send it to PubMed Central. And the XML is currently a fundamental constraint on innovation, on bringing content to the web. And that's the problem that Rebecca was referring to earlier about needing to get around some of these constraints and get to standardization. And that's what I want to talk about today. Now, PubMed Central, I don't want to be down on them. They have an impossibly difficult job. They need to try and standardize over about 2.1 million articles per year. So they're doing the right thing. But as publishers, because we need to produce the PDFs, we now do an XML-first workflow, whereas actually probably XML should be an output of a more flexible document system. But it isn't at this point in time. OK, so what are some of the problems of how we make these scientific papers. One of the problems is that XML has limitations. That specific tag set that we send to PubMed Central has a specific set of named tags. It is a fixed ontology. And so if we want to introduce a new kind of thing into the published record, we are constrained by either cheating or changing that specification. So in this example here, this is how we refer to a figure. We have a graphic type in the node, and we refer to a particular resource, and there's support for those kinds of graphics and figures, but there isn't any support for interactive graphic. There isn't any support for data set, although we've recently introduced a new standard to cite data, but it took a couple of years and a large number of people on a working group to even add just a few number of small tags. I was happily involved in that. The tag set is limited. XML is not a dynamic format. Once we coin that XML, everyone in the industry assumes that that is kind of a preserved, frozen piece of the literature. And the reason is that the XML tag set that we're using was designed in order to carry over translation from OCR'd versions of articles that were sitting on shelves into a digital format, and to kind of freeze those digitally to go into the PubMed Central Archive. And so the DTD doesn't come with any kind of overall sense of a philosophical approach to how you would describe an article. It's entirely pragmatic. Okay. The XML gets converted to HTML. The systems we use to convert that XML to HTML are a bit ropey, they're a bit flaky. In particular, HTML itself has got a limited tag set, so it's not as expressive as you might want it to be at this point in time to represent an academic publication. And ELIFE's HTML in particular is a little div soup heavy, so I'm going to show that. So here we have a nice ELIFE paper. It looks very pretty. It's like, ooh, isn't that very nice? Yes. But then if we look at it in three dimensions and we go around the side, it's terrifying. It's like terrifying. So I want you guys to keep this in mind, right? This is the kind of like the scaffolding of the architecture of the HTML that we use to represent one of our articles. And yeah, we haven't even got to the bit that shows like the figure, which is like, I can't even know how to get there, but like there. See, these are the figures down here, and it's just horrible. Okay, so I'll minimize that. Okay. But notwithstanding that, researchers, you guys, you want to tell the best story you possibly can. You want to tell the most compelling story you possibly can. And you often come to the publisher and say, can I do this? And we go, no, because of all of the things that I've just explained to you. And you very reasonably go, well, why not? Because it's so simple. I just have this thing that I want to do, and you won't let me do it. And so we've tried. This is where now we have to start thinking about what we need to do next in this industry, in the publishing industry. And we've looked at a couple of things at eLife to get around some of these problems, and we're learning. And this is one of the reasons why I'm excited about BioJS's potential platform for this. And so I'm just going to give an example of a few stories of some of the things that we've done that are trying to get around there. I think F1000 are way ahead of us on this, but I want to just show you an example of some of the kinds of conversations we've had. So we had a group who produced this interactive genomic analysis with human immune response to influenza. And they created this tool in their lab, which was backed by a small database. And it leads into thousands of Manhattan plots looking at particular pieces of data. I'm not a biologist. I don't know what any of this stuff means. But it's clearly rich. It's clearly a lot of data. It clearly could be really interesting to readers. And they said, you know, can we add this into the article? And we were like, no. No, we can't. Like, all you can do is this. All you can have is this one image. And they said, well, can we point back to our tool? It's sitting on our servers. And we found a way to get them to convert their database back tool into a single web page application so that at least it could be bundled into one thing that could be pointed to from our article, put into an archive, so that when their server disappears, which it inevitably will, people can still get access to that artifact. And so what I have here is I have an example of that artifact that was turned into a single web page application, downloaded from Zenodo, re-uncompressed on my machine, and then this is the kind of stuff that you can get access to. And and this is, oh, I know what I was looking for. Table. Oh, sorry. I think I'm going to stop trying the live demo of this right now. Yes, I'm going to move on. Okay, so another example was a researcher who very recently came to us and said, you know, I've got this D3JS in visualization that I've been working on. I'd very much like to have it published as part of my article. I think this is great, but we had to say to this person, no, we can't do this. We don't have a way to take this thing and produce it as part of our article on our website at this point in time. And if any of you write a paper that have a BioJS visualization in it at the moment, we're stuck in the same situation. We were not currently able to do this. But I think there is a way forward that we would like to experiment with. And I guess this is the point of what I want to talk about, and it's web components. So how many people here know about web components? Okay, most of you. So I actually probably don't need to do this part of my talk. But we are excited about them. So I'm probably going to tell you a lot of stuff that you know already. And if I tell you lies, you can interrupt me and tell me what I am saying that is not true. So what problem do they propose solving? Right, they principally provide this idea that you can have encapsulation of components in a web page. Why that is important for us, particularly in eLife, is if you think back to this crazy div architecture that we have on our site, if we start introducing random components into our site, I principally do not want to break the rest of that architecture because it could have unintended side effects which could break pages on our site. And as a publisher, I don't want to do that because I don't want to destroy the rest of the pages on my site because of your visualization. So if you can give it to me in a way that is isolated and is isolated in the DOM and is isolated in its side effects, that is extremely appealing to me. It potentially makes it easier to add extensible features and functionality into a complex site, and it potentially makes distribution of those components easier. Web components are comprised of custom elements, the shadow DOM, HTML imports, and HTML templates. And it's this shadow DOM in particular which can hide rich functionality inside of a new named node that allows you to introduce that kind of interesting complex functionality to a site without those ugly side effects. So how do you implement them? I'm just going to show like a demo that we did internally for ourselves. We had another author who created this visualization for their paper. Again, they were working with D3, and they thought, well, wouldn't it be great if we could put this in as part of the paper? We can't support that yet. But we did prove that we could convert it relatively painlessly into a web component. And so if we look at the page source for this page,
develop maybe.
Thank you. That's my. I've just got glasses recently. I don't know if they're helping. Have 5 minutes? I've got more to it. So you see in the page, we that's what we've done. We've just created here this new FluAHN2 component. There it is. And it's just this thing right here that is pulling in all of the functionality for that visualization. So we think that what we'd like to do is we would like to take enough control of our production system so that when you submit and you're submitting things like your figures and your tables and your data sets, if you submit something like this, we can either work with you at that point of submission or work with our content processors in India to wrap these things in an appropriate named web component and then pull that through completely transparently through the production system so they can get delivered to the website, and the website can then show this in a way that is risk-free to the rest of the application that's running that website. And so this is the kind of approach that I was mentioning to you about 2 weeks ago, and I think there's a lot of potential in that. And I think it can get around some of those problems that you've probably seen in implementing some of the interactive figures. So that is what I think is a compelling idea of how we can move forward and get us maybe not 20 years up to date, but maybe 15 years up to date, which would be a good start. I was going to talk about a few other things, but I don't need to, so I'm going to stop.
Thank you very much. So we have time for a few questions. I will go first there, and we'll come back to you.
Thank you. First question, so what's the impact factor? So the second question, does it completely protect in terms of like CPU usage? If you throw like a huge network on there with thousands of nodes, is it going to kill the browser? In what way does it fully sandbox?
Yes, that will potentially kill the browser.
Yeah,
because it's still going to run its own independent JavaScript and CSS, but it protects the outer CSS and DOM addressing any of the styling or JavaScript or interactions that are going on inside of the component. So from the point of view of someone who has an application, where it means I don't have to code review your visualization to make sure that it's going to cause any danger to my site.
Sorry, can I just ask one more thing? In terms of encapsulating the data behind that and the data sources behind that,
So as a publisher, I would prefer to see those data sources derived locally, that we would take that in as the package and it's just read in from the JavaScript file locally, but it would require cores to be enabled on any server if it was using a web service.
Before I give the word to Henning and Michiel, I wanted to ask Sebastian or someone that manages the registry, do we have any web components already in BioJS?
So
our plans are actually, Sebastian will talk later about it, like when he gives his lightning talk about the future of BioJS, that we want to transfer some of our most important components into web components. So we started with the phylogenetic tree and MSA component to somehow adapt it into the Google web component stuff with Polymer, but it's work in progress.
I mean, I think from your point of view, that's great. But I think from my point of view, if we can get this working in production workflow, it's kind of going to be irrelevant. Because the way it would work for us is an author would come with a visualization. We would then say to the author, in order to accept that, we need to wrap it in the eLife generic component. And if it comes from the component ready, that makes up that process faster. But it wouldn't necessarily be a must. But I also want to emphasize, this is just something that we are thinking about. I cannot promise that we can deliver on this, but I can promise that I hope that we will try.
Okay, so this is just asking again the last part of the previous question. So I was surprised, it seems you said it wouldn't make a big difference to you if once you have this web component system, whether it's all one shrink wrap package without external dependencies or if there are, let's say, web service calls. Is that really what you said? Because I'm surprised. I would have expected that you would say it has to be completely independent and no external calls, full stop.
That's a good question. My intuitive answer is that my preference is it should not depend on a web service call, because if it's for the scholarly record, then you're introducing something that is essentially fragile. But if it's a value add thing, and it's paper dependent on data that was available in a web service call that was transient in any case, but there was sufficient information in the paper to make that work reproducible, if that web service call is just value add, then there might be a case to do that. In the end, it will become, I don't think I can be black and white about it at this point, I think it will come down to data, just decisions about policies on data, editorial decisions, complexity of how heavy that app is, all those kinds of things. We don't know yet. These are some of the questions we need to find out in the next few years.
Sorry.
The answers to.
Michiel, the last question.
Two quick questions. First of all, is crappy Word document the standard way to deliver papers to you?
Yeah, like 96%. And the other 4% are crappy LaTeX files.
I see.
And the thing I was going to talk about in time to, which is really cool, is HTML5 editors. So there's one in particular I was going to demo by Manuscripts app,
And I think that we're at the cusp of being at a point where we can very quickly convert Word files, docx files, into HTML files and go from there and make that be the unit of delivery through the whole workflow instead of XML. And it's an area I'm very excited about potentially. Like, if you think about the Atom editor from GitHub, and that's a web, that's like web, you know, think, yeah, and a number of really interesting examples of how we can get away from that.
Secondly, when you pose your problem there, the very first thing that comes to my mind is iframes. The problem most people have with iframes is that they encapsulate too much, but it seems ideal for you. Have you considered this?
I actually asked my front-end developer yesterday, why not this over iframes? And this encapsulation, where we can put it on our own server, I think it seems to us to be a neater way of doing it. It also means that you can potentially also have interactions between the components or the elements outside of the component if you wish, which is very difficult to do with the iframes.
Yeah, I didn't imagine that would ever be needed in your case. But yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ian. So the next speaker can prepare. So thank you. So Michiel, I came here to pronounce your surname. So it's Michiel Helvensteijn, as far as I understand.
Very good.
Good. So just to say a few words about Michiel. So you might know Michiel because he is working in the development of this amazing tool that I think he's going to present, ApiNATOMY. And yes, I think I had the pleasure to meet Michiel before in teleconferences, but actually I met him in the face-to-face in the BioJS hackathon workshop that happened a year ago in August. And well, he was one of the contributors, as well as Sebastian, David, Iris, Manuel, to the new BioJS too, and really appreciate your participation since then, yes?
Thank you.
Yes,
yes.
Yeah, he's looking forward to this because due to an amusing set of miscommunications, I only learned yesterday that I was giving a presentation today. At least it was amusing to the other people at the dinner table. nonetheless, I am fairly confident in certain topics that might help you today and or tomorrow or in the future, because there's a hackathon coming up. So what I'd like to do is first show you ApiNATOMY, because I cannot possibly neglect to do that, because it's just so nice. And then I think that ECMAScript 6. So can I ask people, so how many of you are comfortable with JavaScript in general and programming in JavaScript? And please, hands go down if you're comfortable with ECMAScript 6. If you are comfortable with ECMAScript 6, leave your hands up. So that's one. So I feel like it's probably worthwhile exercise. So let's try that. First of all, let's have a quick look at ApiNATOMY here. It is part of BioJS. And it's a big tree map, in this case with an anatomical ontology. For example, if I go into lungs, then you'll get what is categorized under lungs, what is a part of the lung, and subclasses of both parts, and so forth. So you can categorize and classify data and put it in the right place there. You can navigate human anatomy or other ontologies. Other than that, there's some really cool things we can do with this. For example, it can house other widgets, for example. So take a look at, take a look at this, for example, where inside the brain tile, as we call it, what you're seeing here is protein-protein interaction diagram. Also, we can maximize this to focus on the brain. And we can add 3D stuff as well. So in this case, it's protein-protein interaction diagrams plus protein architectures in the third dimension. So there's some very nice things I think you can do with this, especially if you combine it with other widgets, other BioJS components that can communicate with ApiNATOMY and can be housed inside ApiNATOMY if appropriate. There's a lot more to show about this, but I'd be happy, please come to me and ask, because I'd be happy to talk to you about ApiNATOMY. But I think it might be very fruitful to talk about ECmaScript 6 because there's a hackathon coming up and it's just so very useful. I've set up a small template with index.html. It has just a number of divs where we can just print content later.
and it imports index.js. Index.js, as you might notice, is not there in the source directory. There's index.es6.js. ES6 stands for ECmaScript 6, and not all browsers. So ECmaScript 6, first of all, is the next version of JavaScript, the official version. It's finalized recently, a month ago or so. Not all browsers support this yet, though some do in large part. What you have to do right now is transpile or compile ECmaScript 6 to ECmaScript 5. That's what you serve to the browsers. And I should sort of set this up automatically here. Whenever I make a change, it will automatically transpile, and everything in the dist folder is the distribution of our little tiny app here. And I'm showing it in this tab. So, wait. Let's just restart this because there's too much output. There shouldn't be any output yet. This is Webpack, by the way, and on how to set all of this up, again, I'm happy to talk to you about this offline. It takes a bit too long to do in 20 minutes. So let's refresh here. This is just HTML. And I will minimize this so that we can have it side by side. So first things you might notice about this file is import index.css. I ask you to forget about this for a moment. It's a feature of Webpack, not of ECmaScript 6, to include CSS this way. Still, the import statement itself is, for example, importing jQuery in this way. And it's pretty nice because you can have static analysis on module infrastructure. You can, the order between this doesn't matter, so there can be asynchronous loading as well. It's the new way to do it, new kinds of modules. The second thing you might notice is the fat arrow function notation. In JavaScript, you'll very often feel the need to have an anonymous function as a parameter to some other function. It's just how to write JavaScript, and it's always been a bit verbose. If you want to do this, it's almost the same, though not exactly. And I'll just quickly say the difference is, as you type the word this in here, or the word arguments, right now it does not refer to that arrow function, but to whatever function is just outside of it. It sort of lets the this and the arguments fall through, which is very useful. Other than that, I sort of always use it whenever I need an anonymous function, and I suggest you do too. Just to have a quick, I want a quick way to print things, so let's do function print number content. So that'd be like this. Content 1. So, this, by the way, should be. By the way, the IDE is WebStorm, which I would also really recommend. It's very nice. So, it's almost done, except content 1 is only this first div here, and we want to make it general, so we put in number here. So, how would you do it usually? Something like this, yes? Except ECmaScript 6 is a very nice way of doing this. You use your backticks and you have template strings. So this is sort of the same thing. It's little things like that that make it very very nice to use, I think. So there we go. So let's just try one. And refresh, and so yeah, there we go. Hello, BioJS. That's capitalization instance. Okay, so what's more with ECmaScript 6? There's some nice things. Let's try to get something with an AJAX call from another server, and how to do it traditionally. Well, they're HTML ways, but let's just use jQuery because it's just easier. It goes like this. AJAX, and then you say URL, and in this case I'm using this test server here, where you can just get some silly JSON data back, like the time or your current IP address. And I think data type should be JSONP, and then in jQuery do success, and this will be your this will be your callback function with the data inside. So we can just quickly do this, print 2, data.ip. I just happen to know that's what the object has inside. Let's see if that works. There we go. Good enough. So there's a couple of things we can fix here with ECMAScript 6. One of them is method notation inside objects. It's a small thing, but it's nice, and people with experience with Java and C++ are familiar with this notation. So this will just work the exact same way. Almost the exact same way. This is a non-fat arrow function, so this and arguments will refer to this method. Other than that, we're printing IP here, but we don't care about the rest of the data object. So then we can use destructuring. If we know we're expecting an object that has an IP field, and we only care about that IP field, you just do it like this. This part of ECmaScript 6, it will be supported in browsers. It's just so nice. I sort of always use it automatically now. Okay. And let's just refresh to see that it's still working. And yes, it is. Still, this is not. This is fine, but let's say we want to add something else to this. We want to also add the time. So we need to do another call to time.jsontest.com, and then we get the time field from that. And let's print IP, or we do it this way. So that should be fine, probably. I don't think I made many mistakes. Okay, so that's fine. This is what they call callback hell, because if you want more and more data fetched sequentially this way, you'll have to nest it deeper and deeper and deeper, right, in the traditional callback way of doing things. So how many of you know about promises? Okay, so that's a bit more than before. Promises have been around longer than ECmaScript 6, but ECmaScript 6 comes with native promises. And this is just nice. So let's try this with promises. So we say it's something like this. Let is the new var. We can do var, and it's localized inside that function. Let is localized inside the deepest scope block, the bracket block, if you will. There's a couple of other small differences that are not as important. Just use let from now on. This is how you create a new promise. I should quickly say what a promise is. A promise is it is what it is. It promises a value to you that's not yet computed, or is being computed, or maybe it has already computed. The point is, it's a value that may not necessarily be there yet, and you can pass it around while it's not necessarily there yet. That's an interesting way to program, and a useful one. Let's see, we want here success function and error function. And this is the place where we fetch the data and call those callback functions appropriately. So we just paste this inside. Oh. Success is a success function. And by the way, we could also have done this earlier, error function, an error handler. Okay, now we can do ip.then. That's how you work with promises. IP. Print 2, IP. So we now separated the arguments of a function and sort of the return value. First we had to put the return value inside the arguments. And that's not really a nice way to work. Also, it will solve callback hell, which I'll show you later. So this is just working fine. By the way, there's another nice ECmaScript 6 thing. If we rename this to success and error exactly, we don't have to repeat them here. This is the same thing, because it's the same as saying success. So, small thing there, that's nice. All right, then we create another one for time. But let's...
Do we have a
minute? This is going really fast. Okay,
Well, let's not create another one for time. I just wanted to show you generator functions, if I can do so quickly enough. So function with a star inside. Let's do Fibonacci. If you want to create the sequence of Fibonacci numbers, you can do something like A equals 0, B equals 1, then something like while true. I'll just use yield immediately. Yield A, and then A comma B becomes B comma A plus B. So this is another nice example of destructuring there, a sort of a swap. The thing that yield does is you can call Fibonacci, let iterator Fibonacci, and then you can say print 3 comma iterator next dot value. So there's a code construct so that you don't have to type all of this. But if we just do this a couple of times, it will just lazily compute the next value of the sequence. There, I didn't put any spaces, but you understand the point. You can use sequential code to do sequential looking code, I should say, to do things that are inherently asynchronous, like going back and computing the next one, and going back and computing the next one. You can use this in combination with promises to make the Ajax calls I did earlier look like sequential code, which is really nice. And I don't have time to show you. Please go ahead. Thanks.
Good. Thank you very much.
We have time for a couple of questions. Anybody? Okay.
Maybe what's the first one?
So it looks very promising, especially the promises. Anyway, so what is your like favorite ECmaScript 6 feature?
Well, the answer is just very unsophisticated, because I'm going to say fat arrow functions, because make everything look nicer, but it's certainly not the most revolutionary. That would be generators, very likely. Promises are very important, but are not really an ECmaScript 6 invention as such. Those are very nice.
Sorry, I have the last one. You don't mind?
Can we start developing with this script so that in the future, whenever it comes production ready, can we use it?
You can use it now. And you can use, there are two transpilers, actually the most popular one is Babel right now, and it supports all of ECmaScript 6 and more. It supports some ECmaScript 7 even, and I think some JSX and some other things as well. The point is you compile your ES6 file to an ECmaScript 5 version of it, and then that's what you give to your browsers, to your clients. In the future, you can skip that step when the browsers have advanced enough.
Good. Thank you very much. Thanks for the very interesting update and introduction. So while Jessie is preparing, I'm going to kind of introduce her. So I was looking at her LinkedIn page, and I saw that she's a dean, a professor, a director. So I know Jessie because I met her in, I don't know if it was BSV or another conference, but I was in Heidelberg. And since then I've been interacting a little bit more. Even I went to Edinburgh to work with part of her team in this nice repository, BBCo, that I think she will be talking about. Yes, BB.co, sorry.
Maybe.
Yes, okay, sorry. Yes, so I think, well, part of her interest is as well visualization, and she's been working in the UK in building up the community of visualization, and she built a very nice registry to register different visualization components. And thank you, Jessie. Looking forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much. So this is another non-BioJS talk. So what I'm really here to do is, if you haven't heard about it, to tell you a little bit about BV, which is this biological visualization community that we're trying to build in the UK and beyond at the moment. So let me just give you a little bit of background to my perception of where the biological visualization started, especially in the UK. So back in September 2008, I actually ran a workshop in the Royal Society of Edinburgh on applications of information visualization and bioinformatics. And there was people from all over Scotland, there was people from EBI that came up and presented the work that they were doing at that point. In March 2010, we had the first VISB conference, and that was in Heidelberg with Sean O'Donoghue leading that initiative. And that now rotates every March between Heidelberg and Boston. In November 2010, we saw the first, BBSRC held a workshop where they introduced speakers, international speakers, and invited people that from the UK BBSRC community to a workshop on the challenges in visualizing biological data. And at that point, BBSRC, I think, saw the importance that visualization was going to have for the biological community. And they were at that point hoping that there was going to be a big initiative to fund visualization projects. But as it happened, there was a big restructuring and looking at the funding mechanisms, and it never actually took off at that point, even though the workshop was really very successful and it was oversubscribed for people going to that workshop. In October 2011, we saw the first international symposium in biological data visualization. Now, that's different from VISB, so I'm not sure if you know of both of these events, but I'm hoping that you do, and if you don't, that you'll start to certainly contribute to BioVis. So the difference between BioVis and VISB is VISB was initiated from the biology community, and it was really inviting people that they knew that were working in the field to come and present the work that was going on. So it's a very good venue to go to hear up-to-date developments in visualization from the community and to network with people in that community. BioVis, on the other hand, was developed from the computer science community. So it became part of the IEEE VIS conference that happens every year. So that's the top visualization conference in the world. And the first 3 years, BioVis was co-located with VIS. And it's a different type of conference from VISB, and that for BioVis, it's like a traditional computer science conference where you submit a full paper. It's a full peer-reviewed paper. For getting accepted to give presentations at BioVis. They also have some keynote speakers, and they have challenges, and they have quite a nice idea, which is at the beginning of every session we'll have a primer speaker, and the primer would, for example, maybe there's a session on some sort of sequence visualization, so we would have a biologist in giving a primer about the underlying biology, so that any visualization people coming to that session would understand the biology and then be able to follow the talks on the visualizations of that particular type of biology. For the last 2 years, well, last year and this year, BioVis has been co-located with ISMB, so we're trying to reach out more to the biology community. So when we're at ISMB, the primers tend to be visualization primers. So we'll try to group the papers around a particular type of visualization technique. We'll give a primer on that technique so that the biologists can understand the visualizations and therefore the talks. In September 2013, BBSRC followed up on their 2010 workshop and decided that they really had to do something about this visualization, and they had a workshop where they were wanting to initiate the creation of a network, a BBSRC network in biological visualization. And in 2014, I ended up being the PI for the network grant, and we had that awarded, and that network was launched in 2014. So it's a BBSRC. We call it BV for the biological visualization community. And the idea of BV is to bring together visualization developers and biologists with data for analysis to try to get them to collaborate, to try to educate people of the best way to do things, etc. So it's a 3-year grant from 2014 to 17. And the main aim really is to build this biological visualization community. There's quite a lot of collaborators on the grant from Scotland actually, and around the London area, including a couple of people from TGAC. So Manuel's involved in it, and so is Vicky Schneider on the educational side of the network. So as I said, the aim was to build a biological visualization community. So one of the first things to do that we've done is to set up a website, and the website URL is bv.co for biological visualization community. And really, the idea is for this to become a repository for all materials to do with biological visualization. We're also hosting annual meetings to try and enable multidisciplinary collaborations, and also trying to build up education and training materials for the area. So if you go to bv.co, this is what you're going to see. And it's basically a site with information about visualization tools and biological challenges, different sorts of resources about events, training materials, etc. The site and the network is structured around some biological themes. So we have a range of themes. There's one, anatomy, physiology, and atlases, cells and organisms, genome, molecular, pathway, etc. So this is what we set up, and we're hoping that this is the right way to go about it. Each of the themes has all of the information tailored towards that theme, and there'll be blog posts relevant to the theme. Each of the themes is led by one of these collaborators that I mentioned. Mike Sternberg is the theme leader for the molecular visualization techniques, for example, Mike from Imperial. On the site, there's basically a catalogue of biological visualization tools and techniques. So if you didn't know about it and you've got tools, then please go to the site and register and upload your tools. At the moment, we've got 122 on the system so far, and we're about getting to the stage that we're having to do some more development, thinking about doing development so that people can find what they're looking for. So we're about to look at how best to do that. The visualization tools are structured and tagged with a particular theme that they're relevant, that they're relevant to. So the most popular or populous theme, if you like, is the genome one, which has got currently 49 tools in the system. Most of these tools originally came from the BioViz conference, so we did some pre-population to get the system up and going, and went through the back copies of BioViz, and also some other main tool providers that we knew about. And we added them up, and since then we launched a system. We've announced it at Visby, at BioViz, and some other on BBSRC. And people have since then gone and been adding their tools to the system as well. In terms of annual meetings, we've had one annual meeting so far. That was in December in Edinburgh. And the meeting had some keynote speakers, so I hope you know of them. Martin Krasvinsky, the guy that developed CIRCOS, and Niels Gehlenberg from Harvard, talking, who's doing a lot of cancer genomic visualization tools. So they were there talking about visualization, design principles, and general approaches for biomedical omics data, bringing them all together. And we had talks from the different theme leaders, and we also had talks from people who had already uploaded their tools could volunteer to come and give a talk about their tool. So that was a very successful meeting, I think. Most of the information about the meeting is on the website, so you can find out posters, you can find out presentations, so you can go and you'll be able to see like people like Martin's talk or Niels's talk at the meeting. In terms of the meetings, we will be looking to the second one, which we think is going to be in December. We've not fixed the date. We're just in the middle of talking about that, but it is going to be held here at TGAC. So I hope you'll keep your eyes open for that, and hope to see a lot of you there, and maybe even offering to do some presentations at the meeting. I mentioned that we're having to do some ongoing development for the system, and one of the things that we're wanting to work on is developing some metadata to describe the different visualization tools. So what we're trying to think about is, if a biologist comes along to the website and they're looking for a tool to support them, how are they going to find the one you know, what is it that we need to allow them to search on so that they're going to find a tool that's useful for them? You know, so it might be something to do with the platform or to do with the data formats or to, you know, whatever. But we're trying to look at that aspect at the moment. We're also working with Vicky. We've not really got very much in terms of the training materials apart from the stuff that we've had from the annual meeting, and also some things like there's, you know, adding up information about recent state-of-the-art reviews that have come out of some of the visualization conferences for biological visualization tools. We're also planning, we're finding it quite difficult to get everybody together. I think people work the best, regardless of how much of an e-world we live in. We think that people seem to work best when they're face-to-face. So rather than trying to have a meeting, you know, that we pull everybody together from all over the UK, we're considering starting to have some regional meetings. So London-based meetings and Edinburgh-based meetings are going to be the most likely approach. And of course, the other thing is to spread the word, and that's of course why I'm here, to make sure that all you guys know about the tool and to encourage you to join the community. So to join the community is very easy. Go to bv.co and register on the site. You can add your own material. You can contact us, tell us what we're doing wrong, tell us what we have to do. If you want to get involved in it and actually contribute more in any way, we'd be really keen to have you on board and help. You can contribute your visualization tools. You can contribute events that you know about that are coming up. So the BioJS conference was advertised on the site. The next BioViz is advertised. BioViz is next Friday, actually, in Dublin, if you didn't know about it. This will be next year, I think, back in Boston again. And presentations or videos of your tool, could add them on, relevant courses. Another thing that we're really keen on is if you've got biologists or you know biologists that have got particular challenges that they're looking for collaborators to work with, to get them to post their challenge so that they can then potentially meet somebody that wants to work on that project or can maybe even have a solution for them that can help solve the project as well. And also posting things to the theme blogs. And I guess the best way to do that is to contact the theme leaders. And that's really me. So I'm just a quick talk. So I hope that we'll find some way for getting more of you on board with the community.
Any questions for Jessie? Actually, I was told to leave the microphone here with the speaker. Any questions for Jessie? Yes.
How to get a 3D scan of a tool? Do you have any kind of criteria for the tool to be there, or is it all kind of tool? And if from a user point of view, how can we know that, okay, it's been tested well?
Okay, thank you. So you don't need to get a BV stamp. We basically, all you need to do is register, and we're hoping that the community will police itself. So you can register, you can upload your tool. Now, then, of course, it becomes the question. At a certain point, people will be thinking, I don't want to waste my time using a tool that's rubbish, right, or learning about a tool that's not going to do what I want to do. So one of the things we've been also talking about for development is how we provide that information. So there's a facility to be able to comment at the moment on any tools, and as we build the community, so we've been talking about what's the best way to do this. You know, how will people respond if people are publicly, especially if they're rubbishing somebody's tool, you know, or praising them, and how do we, you know, get votes for it? So there's different techniques that we could use. But we've not got enough of that engagement yet to start providing that information. But that's certainly the kind of thing we want to do, so that we can find a way that's going to meaningfully sort of vote tools up and down the chart, if you like.
Yes. There seems to be some overlap with the stuff that the test people are doing in terms of offering tutorials and information about how tools to use. especially when you talk about ontologies or keywords and stuff. I just wonder whether there is a visual overlap or whether there might be.
So I didn't catch the who people?
Tests. So people in Manchester doing, it's ELIXIR and tests doing like the other.
So this is why we're working with these guys here, so that they are supposed to be keeping us in the loop about all of these things.
This is the ELIXIR training portal, and
it's a training portal that we've looked at then. Okay.
Yes. And I think something that is beneficial for all the repositories is to try to use the same vocabulary to classify at least the topics.
Yeah.
So, for instance, for a resource like visualization, you could say this is for genomics or metagenomics, and we could do the same thing with training materials and probably interlink find the context of the tools with the training.
Yeah, so we've definitely been talking about, Rafael, about, the implementation of the site is based on the same as what is using Drupal, the same as what they're doing, so that we've got that kind of connection. We're doing some reuse there. That's exactly why we were working with them. When it comes to, so talking about the ontology for the tools themselves might be a bit more detailed. So I can imagine that, you know, how you'll describe a tool would be too detailed for this more higher level ontology, but certainly we need to make sure that we stay, talking the same language. But thank you.
Any more questions? I think we have time for one. Otherwise, I will ask the question. So you have a very nice resource. It's a resource. It's a registry of visualization resources, and there are many other resources, registry resources like R3 data or the ELIXIR registry.
Mm-hmm.
And also they have a registry, BioJS, and I was wondering, have you thought about the communication of these registries? For instance, it would be very nice that your registry could pull probably all the components that are available in the BioJS registry. Or do you have the BioJS components? Do the community have to go to the BioJS registry and to your registry to register components? Can we avoid the registration twice?
Yes, I would hope so. So I'm going to embarrass the BioJS and Manuel if he's sitting here, because I keep reminding him that he's still not registered BioJS at all on the site, and he told me the last time he was ashamed and he was going to go and do it. So it's more, so we're not, it's more about if there's somewhere that people can go and find out about. So it's only registration, as in it's like treating this as a catalogue, and we're never going to be uploading everything here. We will be redirecting you to where to get things. And this would just be to allow people to talk about, you know, any tool. So we certainly are not wanting to duplicate, but I've just embarrassed you publicly, Manuel, when you weren't here. Because you still haven't registered BioJS. So. So you can see, you can choose a particular theme, and it'll pull up the different tools that are relevant to your theme. So you can go and play around with it when you get a chance.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So while our next speaker, MacLean, prepares,
thank you.
I will say a few words about him. So I think I didn't have the chance to meet Dan before, isn't it? Okay. So he's head of bioinformatics in the Sainsbury Laboratory, focused on genomics. I was browsing about his publications, and I saw that one of his last publications, it was about the SAM tools, and he got very nice visualizations. I saw a connection with BioNode, but I don't know what that connection could be. And something that I was pleasantly surprised is that I realized that we have a publication together. The goblet training portals is something that we work together. It's a big community, so it's sometimes difficult to know who you're working with.
Mm.
So, Dan, thank you very much, and we look forward for your presentation.
Let's try and get it on the screen. Our next topic. Hello, BioJS. It's a pleasure to be here to speak about visualisation with you. It's also a bit odd because I'm a biologist by training and a bioinformatician by profession. And I don't do much visualisation, but I've spent a lot of time looking at pictures of data that have been rendered by my own and by other people's software. And because BioJS is a great place right now, I thought I'd try and take an opportunity to get on my high horse, basically, and tell you how I think that the visualizations that I've come across have succeeded and failed in their apparent tasks. And hopefully seed some discussions about what I think you, the developers of BioJS's killer visualization apps, we'll be making. So this picture is of radio signals from a pulsar star that was prepared for a PhD thesis in scientific data, but it made its way to the cover of an album called Unknown Pleasures by a band called Joy Division. That's why I've named this talk that. So the first thing I want to consider is what for me is the reason for having a visualization in the first place. So visualization is a form of communication. It's a way of expressing the story data has in it. It's not fanciful or fictional expression though. It isn't an artistic interpretation. I mean, some visualizations really blur the line between data and artistic interpretations, like this one, which is a visualization of the sonic channels of a song split into separate lines, and the offset angle is representing the frequency of sound in the channel, with the higher frequencies tipped in orange. It's very pretty indeed, but the best result in a scientific visualization is not about the visual alone. It's in part about the story from the source data, like this one. And this visualization you've probably seen before, but this tells a magnificent story, kind of an epic one, one of futility, one of death. And this line, thick line through the middle, represents the strength of Napoleon's army as it marched across Russia. And it tells its own tale, really, such as the power of the visualization. You see that as they march east into Russia, they get the line gets thinner, they get smaller and smaller in numbers, and then basically they have to give up and turn around, and there's virtually none of them left by the time they get back to France. But it's really just a tale of statistics. It's just about the change in army size by position. And strong visualization can express abstract concepts as well as narratives. So this figure expresses in a quite immediate way the truth of Pythagoras' theorem. It's a visual proof that conveys things in a very different way to a long-winded and dry algebraic one that we all see in textbooks. So a good visualization is a writer's tool that can be thought of as a form of journalism driven by data. And the thing about these and all successful visualizations is that they don't just pop into existence. There's a process of drafting that builds on a previous, presumably less satisfactory visualization, and the story needs to be unearthed as you go along. No one will know what the story is until you've investigated the data. And this is exactly where visualization tools and data investigation tools come in. So the role of BioJS in visualization then is quite clear. BioJS, for me, should be about the tools for allowing someone else to find the story in the data. As a developer, you're not trying to do stuff that encapsulates the story. You're not doing the visualization. You're there to build the thing that will help a biologist discover the meaning in the data and for which they can build the final story and visualization. So if you and I are going to get on BioJS and you're going to produce the sort of tools that someone like me can use, I thought it would be worth looking at what might make a viz succeed and what the techniques are that have been developed to that end. And that's what I'll do in the rest of this talk. So some of this is going to be accepted wisdom. Some of it will be stuff that I think is cool or has been crap. And I'll start with stuff that I really never got. Some stuff that made me confused when I thought it was supposed to be enlightening me. Let's take a look at this thing. So the bits around the outside are supposed to be either chromosome regions or genes, and the ribbons in the middle are supposed to be linking the levels of association between abnormalities detected between the things on the outside by fluorescent in situ hybridization. So when I see this, I instantly get one thought, and it's this one. I don't know what I'm looking at, which isn't helpful. Visualization really fails on that score. Gets better over and over. There's nothing here in this picture but a mess, and I at least am left with the feeling that getting any message or story out of that plot is going to be a bit like reading the tea leaves in a drained cup, which isn't very helpful. So let's have a look at it again. So you might be thinking, you know, it's unfair to judge until you've read the legend. Well, arguably having to need a big legend to work out a growth picture is probably a failure in itself. But let's see. So it says, in the inner ring, the width of each coloured ribbon is proportional with the frequency of other paired lesion within the group harbouring the particular aberration. The exact frequency values are indicated around the inner ring. A gradual transition of colours from lilac to orange also refers to the various strength of associations. Circles plot was generated based on data in supplementary table 4. So, two things with that. they say a gradual transition of colours from lilac to orange. You heard laughter. Everybody knows, right, and can easily interpret the lilac to orange scale. So there's nothing wrong with that. And honestly, I'm not even sure without looking up exactly what lilac is. It's a bit like a pale purple colour, isn't it? And second, they say, the circles plot was generated based on data in supplementary table 4. And this is that table. It's a little bit small, but it's much easier to see in the table what the level of similarity and differences are. The table from which they generated the plot is easier to understand than the visualization. That's a significant failure. So that visualization's horrid. It's illegible, it's meaningless because it tells no story, and it's worse than the table it came from. And it's a circle for no good reason. And in fact, it's more than a circle. You'll recognize it's a CIRCOS plot. I expect you're familiar with CIRCOS. It gets used a lot. And partially because of CIRCOS, circles are cool, and perhaps they shouldn't be. And this bad visualization exists because CIRCOS is cool, and the authors couldn't bear to give up the idea of making a plot when they should. The whole thing was a UUOC, a useless use of CIRCOS. So none of these abuses, though, are CIRCOS' fault. CIRCOS didn't make those authors produce the plot like that, but it is a powerful system that gives them absolute control over what they were producing. The power and flexibility of something like CIRCOS is very impressive, and it's impressed a lot of people with that power. So people who don't know any better are just abusing it, like they do with older plotting tools. It may be visualization heresy to say so, but CIRCOS has gone some way to become the new Microsoft Excel. Sort of warning for any future BioJS biz developer. One of the things that a BioJS biz must do, in my view, to avoid becoming another abusable biz system is take care to provide constraints in the tools that prevent that from happening. Thankfully, these constraints aren't really constraints in the sense of forbidding people from what they can do. They're really rules that provide boundaries within which great stuff can emerge. So, there are a lot of style guides for writing, and lots of writers have spoken in favour of simplicity for clarity. And the basic philosophy behind this is that clarity of writing follows clarity of thought, and that there's an analogue for understanding. Clarity of understanding follows clarity of seeing or presentation. So this is roughly the same as less is more, but it's not just that, it's about economy as well. So I could go on about that for a long time, but it's easy just to see it. Here's an obligatory pie chart bashing slide that conveys a good idea of how you get to clarity. So if you only remember one thing from this talk, remember, emphasize the bacon. Okay, so not surprisingly, a large number of very smart people have looked into this. I imagine a lot of you already know Tuckley. And these two books are a bare minimum read on what constitutes a good graphic, so you should read them if you haven't. You should read them if you haven't. But what the central concept, and it was mentioned earlier, that Tuckley talks about for achieving clarity is the reduction of data ink. And this is the idea that you don't waste printing ink on stuff in the chart that isn't data. And this is a really solid concept. But one significant difference between the Tuckley way of doing things and the way that BioJS will be doing things is that BioJS won't be needing so much ink, or probably any. The graphics on the web have some strong advantages, and as a user of visualizations, I'm going to take just a minute to briefly mention the ones that really make my life a lot better. So the main difference between the Tuffy world and the web world is that you don't just have a flat page. You have many layers that can be hidden initially, that you can then drill down through and add stuff on demand. In particular, things like precise values, scale changes, filters and tools that increase specificity, from a general picture to a well-defined subset, are all good. Other things that I like are data filters, so taking away data points or even entire data sets is an advantage that really do the most to simplify a data set, just help you get rid of stuff that isn't immediately relevant. Mouse solvers as well, these are a killer. I love these. And these can be more than tooltips. They're a great data hunting device. They're perfect for people like me, because I'm forgetful and I'm always forgetting what in a plot is which. Data export as well, it's a really good thing, especially if it's an export of the data currently visible. I know this takes away from the viz itself, but it does help us link to the outside world, which any interactive viz should do. And any viz that's conscientious enough to only show me relevant data first and not bombard me with visual info is going to get a big plus mark. So by this I mean when you're showing me, say, a scatter plot, don't throw hundreds of colours of data points at me, maybe let me decide on the colours as we go along. And the thing that you can see here is one of the tools from my own group that does some of those things. We developed this to identify SNPs in particular categories from large data sets. Just having a simple filter and colour picker and some mouse overs really speeds up a candidate SNP approach to mutation detection. It's called CandySNP. It is a JavaScript tool, but it's not yet a BioJS one. So, you know, if you're having a hackathon and can't think of anything to do, please feel free to turn it into a BioJS tool. Also, side-by-side comparisons of different aspects of the data using a repeated styler, something that's really useful too. So this is a common thing among viz. Tufty calls them small multiples. In other places they could get called facets or trellises. But they're not really subplots, not like figure 1 part A, figure 1 part B, that may have different data sources. These small bits contain the same classes of data variable, but with different values. And they come into their own as a place in which you can see extra dimensions of change in code. And being able to generate these as I go along in new dynamic panels is a very helpful thing. So finally then, I know you're JavaScript developers, but could you do me a favour and pretend that mobile devices don't exist? I mean, I've never seen a useful viz on my phone or an iPad, and I think the development time probably isn't going to be very useful. And I certainly don't do viz on a really small device like that, so if you're tempted, perhaps think again. I'd really like to let you know that. Also, and I'm sure you're not going to do this to me, being JavaScript types, I'm presumably all Ajax and asynchronous and everything, but please don't send me back to the start with resubmit buttons if you can help it. Nothing makes a visualization and analysis tool feel worse and clunkier than sending me back to the start. You know, even at the very least, I find that a flash, even as a screen redraw, is a big distraction, and I forget what I was thinking and really wrecks my thought process. So, you know, if you can avoid doing things like that, and avoid introducing a 30-second wait while your tool goes to do stuff on a server, please do. So all I really was going to say then, in summary, you know, don't give me all the power that I could possibly have. I will mess it up. I'm irresponsible. I'm stupid. Do things that can help me to find the story in my data. Do help me to emphasize my bacon. And you'll probably do this mostly by helping me to hide stuff that I don't need right now. And for acknowledgements, really, just every scientist who ever made a figure that I happened to look at.
Anybody? Sorry.
I was told to leave it here.
Forgot.
The most controversial thing you said probably is no mobile, please. Because one of the first things these days you learn in web development is mobile first. Is this your opinion, or do you know that this is shared among others of your occupation?
Could you lift that over your head? You see that?
Uh-huh.
It's not really got the screen real estate. So it's my opinion, but I think there's, you know, evidence to back it up. You can't do good visualization, you can't do good thinking about biology and biological data sets on those things. And that's the basis of that argument. I think it's a question of physical constraints. I think I've not got mega eyes and I can't see that sort of thing. Yeah.
I mean, the direction to go on that first is more from a larger architectural question, in that if you have a use case where the site needs to be delivered on mobile, it is far easier to build mobile first than to be aware of what needs to be delivered at that scale. So you can take into account both uses. You can have the site which has the visualizations and access to other attributes or pieces of information, and if there's any part of it that needs to be delivered on a mobile screen, start by building the mobile components first, because that would be far easier. Of course, the perfect truth web development is we should have done mobile first, and we always do mobile later. That's what we want to do.
No more for now. No,
we have one more. Thomas. Thank you very much. Thomas prepares his laptop, I would say a few words. I think I had the chance to meet Thomas in the BioConia meeting happened a few months ago. You might know Thomas because he's been involved in several important projects like Wiki Pathways and PathVisio. And he's involved in this company, EcmaScript, and it's a company that is has expertise in data integration, data visualization, specialized in networks and pathways, as you might have guessed, knowing the expertise of Thomas. Okay, so besides that, I don't have more.
So yeah, I'm co-founder of EdgeLeap, which is a really young SME and based in the Netherlands, in Utrecht, and we provide data science solutions to life science industry customers. And today I'm going to talk, it's also not a BioJS talk really, so I'm sorry for that. But I'm going to just show you one of our projects where we visualize complex interactions between food and health. So, everybody wants to get this population more healthy, right? We all want to live happier, healthier lives. But in order to do that, we really need to start with the person, with individuals. And within an individual, to make this individual healthy, there's lots of complex aspects that you need to take into account, that interact with each other, that influence each other. So, a human is a really complex system. So, if you really want to make a human, or keep a human healthy, you really need to take all these aspects into account, as well as the interactions among them. While this is complex nowadays, I think we can measure so much data that we're actually we're getting close to be able to tackle that complexity. There are cell measurement devices, we can do big screenings, we can measure your genome, lots of phenotypes. So actually on each of these aspects we can we have information to try and to understand health and to try and to convert that information into actionable knowledge. But that's actually also where the gap is. We can generate lots of data and there's lots of focus on storing this data, computing power to analyze that, but there's still this gap from all this data and high tech to understanding to translating it to really actionable knowledge. As a company, try to help to tackle that challenge. So we try to move from big data to the big picture. And we do that by on one hand, integrating all the data that comes in and analyzing that in an integrated way, so not to discriminate, not to see, to analyze from the perspective of genetics, from the perspective of phenotype, but really try to see the whole big picture, these different layers of complexity. And on the other hand, what we think is critical is to integrate what you already know into this analysis. So in new insights should come both from the data, but also in context of what we already know about the system. And we know a lot, and there's lots of public resources that that store this knowledge. So in practice, how we do that is, we have a knowledge platform where we integrate many different types of public knowledge. For our customers, we build for very specific questions, we build customized multi-layer network models and workflows to analyze that data and context of the knowledge. And visualization is an important aspect in that in these analyses. So just to step a bit out of biology and show you why I think that visualization, especially network visualization, is really key to understand complex data and why it's really often really works well to understand a bit more about the complex system. So this was something we did for a conference where we showed this before. We got this long participant list, and what you start doing there, if you go, you start to cross all the people that you know and cross all the people that you want to see, want to speak and want to get to know, and you want to get an idea like from this institute, are people there, from which countries are people there. And it's not a very good overview, in my opinion. So we quickly made this visualization where we connected all the persons with their institutes and institutes with the countries they're in and everything to the big community that conference was about. And then you can immediately see much more things. You can see for each country how well represented it is. So we scale the flags by the number of participants. But you can also see more subtle patterns, like if you look at the difference between the Netherlands and Britain, or UK, you see that the Netherlands is quite inefficient. They have some institutes that send many people. There are very fewer institutes, but Britain actually seems way more efficient. They just, for each institute, they send one person speaking. Send way more institutes. So, and another nice thing about this is if you model something as a network, it's kind of abstract and you can project data on top of it. So you can project different data layers. So so we just quickly exported our LinkedIn data and node relatable and colored each person red that we know. And then you can immediately see where you should maybe pay more attention in which area, which you're networking. So now to go back to biology. This is, I'm just going to show you an internal research project that we did, just to give some idea about what we can do with an eye on the future, where we, this really came out of the need of, if you measure a genetics profile, so for example 23andMe, we did that, and for me personally it was a bit of a disappointment, because what you get out of is you get the raw data, but what they do analysis-wise is they give you risk profiles for each disease. And for me it was kind of, yeah, it's okay, I have maybe slightly increased risk of type 2 diabetes, but what should I do? What can I do with that information? Nothing really. So we try to make that knowledge a little bit more actionable in context of food. So this is our idea of the future. You measure lots of data about yourself, and it's continuously increasing. We have these little Fitbit devices and dial watches and everything, so we measure a lot about ourselves. And we really think that this all should be integrated in models that actually give you simple information, like I should eat more apples, less bread, I should sleep more, sleep less. And that's our idea. And this is a tiny baby step towards that, where we looked at the relation between food, diseases and drugs in context of your own genetics information. So we integrate different data types here. We integrate databases of food and ingredients in the food. We integrate databases about drugs. We integrate databases about diseases. And then we put on top of that knowledge about genetic interactions and about your own genetic profile. So in practice, this illustrates how we do that. We take all the ingredients from databases that describe food, drugs, and disease, and each of these databases provides a link to the genes. So for example, for food ingredients, the genes could encode for an enzyme that metabolizes those ingredients. For drug, it could be a target, or also an enzyme that processes the drug. For disease, it could be a genetic association that increases or decreases the risk to that disease. And by linking it to these genes, you can indirectly link these three elements together. So you can look at the overlap and see if there's a lot of overlap. Lots of genes may be overlapping between the ingredient and the disease, and there might be a relevant interaction. And then finally, how to link this to your personal profile. Out of your personal genetics profile, you can derive risk profiles on diseases, and that with some few steps, you can derive to the diseases in the network, and there's some conversion involved because of everybody chooses different standards to describe diseases, and you can measure, you can link the SNPs in the 23andMe profile to the genes in this network, and this way we can make the network personalized. So if we do this systematically for all the diseases, ingredients, and drugs, you get a big network out of it that links these three entities together whenever that seems relevant. And just to show you the example of just diseases and ingredients, so this is how it looks like if you organize ingredients and diseases together based on their relations. And this is rather complex, but already by overlaying here some extra levels, you can see some patterns. So you can, for example, color the diseases by disease class. And then you actually see that by organizing diseases, based on the links to food. So this, we don't link the diseases directly, we link them to food. You can already replicate disease clusters. So it seems that similar diseases actually link to similar food ingredients. The other way around, you can see, you can check if there's any clustering involved in ingredients. And for some ingredient classes, you actually see that happen, but for example, amino acids, they're all over the place. And then to go personalized, of course, for each person, this network would look different, because you can highlight the diseases for that specific person that have an increased or decreased risk, so the blue and red dots here. And you can then, based on that, you can also highlight the ingredients that for that person may be relevant based on their disease risk profile. So you get a lot of different networks. For each person, you have your own personalized, basically relevant ingredient space. And we can do this a little bit more systematically. So we can, for example, cluster the network based on topology. And then what you see is that actually almost every topology cluster in the network, so every group of nodes that, that clusters together, is enriched with a specific disease class or a specific ingredient class. So you should really see that, that these things group together. And this may help you to, for a specific disease, find ingredients that may be really relevant for that disease, or the other way around, for a set of ingredients. So say a food, new food project, a product that you're developing as a company, to see, hey, for which diseases may this be relevant? And then you can, for example, for your own personalized profile, you can zoom in and you can look for me which ingredients are relevant in context of my increase or decrease of disease risk. So so if you, for example, then zoom in on one disease, if I see that I have an increased risk of atherosclerosis, I can immediately see, okay, what are the ingredients linking to that? And I can also go a little bit further, because the edges, underneath these edges are genes, right, that link these two together. And I know from which SNPs this increased risk in atherosclerosis comes. So I can filter this and say, okay, maybe maybe this ingredient is always linked to atherosclerosis. The gene that gives me this increased risk is not shared among these two, so probably that ingredient is not that relevant for me. But the other ones may be. So that gives you a bit more focused information. That in this case of overall, vitamin E may not be that relevant for you to battle your increased risk of atherosclerosis. And then you can also expand it again. You can say, okay, for these four ingredients that are relevant for me, what are the other diseases linked to that? And do I have an increased or decreased risk? So you can explore your profile in a way more interactive, informative way this way. And you can go even one step further. If we take drugs along here, you can do the same for drugs. And you can say, okay, which drugs, in which targets or enzymes that metabolize the drug, do I have that mutation that causes my increased, or is associated to my increased risk to atherosclerosis? So you can really can get more actionable information out of your risk profile. And in the end, I'm convinced that this genetics is not everything. And actually, for food, it's probably not even the most important layer to look at. We happen to be able to measure that relatively easily and cheaply, but it's really the state in which you are now is really more relevant to predict which ingredients you should not take. So in time, when we measure more and more about ourselves, I think these models can only improve to give you better predictions and better advice. So as I said, EdgeLeap is based in Utrecht, and I just have one talk visualization that we made to run the background, so if you have any questions, please come. Thank you.
Any questions for Thomas?
So you mentioned SNPs and your genetic code, but I'm interested to understand a little bit how you see meta microbiota, microbiome systems impacting our current understanding of the relationships between food and health and reactions.
Right. Yeah, so the microbiome is really old now, and we have a couple of projects that actually involve that layer as well. And it's really interesting because it's really relevant, of course, for food. So one of the projects actually will measure oral microbial, which is really relevant to metabolize some of the micronutrients that end up in your body. So there I think it's really, it will really help to stratify stratify populations and to give you, it will be yet another profile to help you to give more directed advice on what you, what food would be good or not good for you. I think that's really a good use of it.
Yeah, I have a question actually. It's a very simple question maybe. Like, how do you validate and verify that the suggestions are correct, or how do you estimate the impact of following the suggested decisions? Is there something? Can you put it in numbers? Or I mean, it's very hard. I know.
Yeah. It's very hard. The one good one part of the analysis that gives us trust that it actually makes sense is this clustering that we actually see. That things that we know are related also cluster together to some extent. So that gives me confidence that you can reproduce what we before already saw, because these groups they come out of our current knowledge. But it's this was for us really a research project, so it's not yet there that I will go provide this as a service to clients to give them diet advice. Okay. It's not there yet. I would also really like to see if we can give a directionality, because right now you have an association, and it would be really good if we could say, okay, you should have higher or lower intake of that ingredient. But that's right now it's just not possible. So there are definitely lots of ways to improve. But I think the basic concept based on what we see, if you look at several. If you see that you can reproduce kind of the grouping that you already know of, I think that's a good indication that of quality.
In the same direction, probably even a bit more, I don't know, critical or provocative, but how specific are these suggestions? You had one slide there which was basically do more exercise, less, so if you just do sort of common sense free advice, pieces of advice, how often would they be the same you predict with a very complex system? And then more realistic then, did you ever test if you give very specific advice, do you then have a better compliance rate? Because then it would still be useful, although you might get just as far with more exercise, less food. So if you give very specific advice, if you could achieve a better compliance rate in your plant anyway. So did you ever test that?
No. So I have to make clear, this is really wasn't a research project, and we did not put this in the field. And I don't think we will anytime soon. I mean, we're not. And I also think that the genetics is really not the. The genetics profile is just alone is not enough to really make good predictions, and that schematic figure with the arrows up and down, that's really it's not there. That's a vision for the future, and I think you really should be as specific as possible with your advices in order for people to follow it up.
Thank you very much. So Thomas was our last speaker, and Manuel, I'm not going to give you the word, sorry. Because they still have few experiments, and I'm very sorry because Ian couldn't finish the presentation. And he was about to say something very important that I got the impression. So I was wondering if you don't mind that Ian extends 3 minutes to finish.
Can everybody hear the last thing I have to say?
You are not intrigued? Or the last?
Sorry, okay. Far be it for me to disappoint you.
which I probably will do now. Okay, so so this is going to answer like briefly one of the questions you raised, Henning, which with the answer being I don't know. Yeah. Okay, so obviously I talked about something that's fairly speculative, and I'm going to talk about something that's even more speculative now. And generally, the sense of what I was saying was that we have these fundamental constraints which come out of a history of submitting in Word and translating those into XML. How can we break out of those constraints? And we can break out of the XML constraint by being a bit creative in our tag sets, maybe. But so long as you guys go through the filter of Word in your submission process, we're going to be in a world of pain, and it's going to be very ugly. So what will come next? The web component thing will definitely solve that. What will come next? Things will come next will be how we deal with dynamic data. And I think it leads to questions like, do we provide a DOI with each iteration in that data set? I don't know the answer. I think one of the other things that's really interesting is how do we connect those visualizations with live computational environments? And someone mentioned R and R Shiny, things that, and you can get R server. And I think IPython notebooks and connecting those to things like maybe Docker containers that can be distributed and isolated and versioned and frozen. Those are all very interesting, and I think that's where we need to look in the next couple of years. But specifically, one thing I'm very excited about is the idea of moving to... HTML5 first. So currently Word can export into a docx format. And I think, and HTML5, I mentioned earlier that HTML itself is a constraint over its tag set, but HTML5 allows us to create new vocabularies within that document. And that document can sit inside of a really powerful compute engine, the browser. And there are some really interesting things going on right now. So my favorite editor, code editor, is Adam. Adam is a WebKit thing. This is just HTML5. And we can write documents in Markdown, and we can get them previewed. We can preview that Markdown of the document, and we get live updating. And so this can be accessed, and we can create namespaces in a document like this. So you could imagine writing your scientific paper with collaborators in something like this, using something like scholarly Markdown instead of Word. You're probably not going to do that just yet, but it's a direction we could go in. This is another example. How many of you have seen the eLife lens viewer that we've created on eLife, way of a kind of two-pane way of viewing articles? Oh, you should check it out. It's awesome. But the guys who developed it have created a prototype for a new scientific editing tool in a web browser. And we can do things like, from here, go in and cite a particular figure, and it'll insert that citation. It'll cross-link to the figure quite nicely. We can edit straight in the browser. This is a live edit. And I think tools like this have the chance to potentially begin to replace the monopoly of Word. And I'll show you one more demo to try and help convince you of this, which is the following one. So somebody here use a tool called Papers for citation referencing, or management, citation management. Anyone use a tool called Mendeley, or anyone use a tool called EndNote? So there's one of these tools called Papers, which does this kind of job. And the CTO of Papers for the last 3 years has been working on a new editing tool. This is it. It looks like a word processor. It's designed specifically for creating scholarly documents. But again, it's just WebKit. And it can export this format into docx. They're working on a version that can read in docx, and it can export straight to the kind of XML that we need to produce to get into PubMed Central. And okay, so you might not be starting to use these tools, but that bridge between docx and a HTML5 artifact is very close. When you go and look and spend time with the typesetters in India, they're all working to get there as quickly as possible to reduce the time it takes to start doing things like the author proofs, the QA, the copy editing, all in a web-based platform. And as we see these tools coming into the production processes, I think they're going to start pushing out to be the kinds of interfaces that you guys see with publishers. And you now have a rich HTML5 artifact. One of the really cool things about this tool is it's JavaScript addressable. So Matthias gave me a demo that doesn't quite work because this is an early build, but you can talk to this document from outside the document purely through JavaScript and start creating interactions with it. And I think this is the future that we need to start moving towards to get really interesting, interactive documents that can help you guys tell the full story of your science onto the web as fast as possible. That was it. Those were the last few things that I wanted to mention. Yeah?
All this looks great. Ideally, you would like to see that happen, but the question is, why did Google fail with Google Docs? Why did Apple fail with Pages and all other things? Compare their market with the research market, bio, it's we are 0.01%.
Sure.
And they still didn't manage to shape word and so on and so forth.
So I need to convince you that this isn't just going to end up being in a ghetto where only a tiny percentage of people use it, okay? That's a really good question. I think that you will see this start to take over in a stealth mode, where what will happen is you will write your Word document, but as soon as you submit it to the publisher will immediately convert it into one of these HTML objects. And from that point, you'll be working with this HTML object. And so rather than go through this painful process of going from Word to awful PDF that I showed you earlier to awful XML, where there are a lot of gaps and it takes a lot of time, and you're being told by publishers that you can't introduce interactive elements and you can't introduce this kind of element or that kind of element, I think we on the publisher community will start providing these things to you immediately upon the moment that you upload your Word file. And you'll start seeing just in the small domain of scientific publishing, you'll start seeing workflows get a bit more efficient. And you might even see publishers say, look, we can even make the system a little faster if you want to use one of these range of tools which already start to talk in this language. I think it'll be a very long time before you as academics completely abandon Word. If anything, the advent of mobile computing is the one area where I have seen a large growth in people starting to write text outside of Word. People are writing text on their mobiles, on their iPads, using a variety of editors, often targeting things that look a little bit like plain text. So the idea that you might be able to answer a question on a web form which has a thing that looks exactly like your document is becoming a little less alien.
Your XML format, is it proprietary or is it open? Anyone can use it? Or is there any mainstream publisher who tries to adopt a similar technology?
Yeah, so the standard that's used by us, by PLOS, by most publishers is called JAPS. It stands for the Journal Archiving Tag Suite. And it's become an industry standard because of PubMed Central's requirement for people to deposit in that standard. For a long time, Elsevier had their own XML DTD, which was proprietary and was in a way richer than the JAPS tag suite, but they're moving over to JAPS. Though my point here is that we should be going beyond JAPS or abandoning XML. But if we do that, we'll probably end up in the same balkanization of lots of different kinds of customized HTML tag suits, HTML5 tag suits, and we'll have to go through some kind of interesting standardization process over the next 10 years or so.
Thank you.